I was going to do that thing where, like, you turn the whole chair around, and, like, I turn around mysteriously, but there's actually not enough room to do that. Hey, what's going on, guys? Welcome back to the channel. Hope that you're having an awesome day. My name is Justin. I'm sorry that I have all these wires, like, everywhere. Oh, my God. Today, we are listening to Vangelis with his album, Heaven and Hell. This is... released in 1975. So many of you guys have recommended this album to me, and it seems like it's pretty much just two long sides, so I figured why not just take this weekend, next weekend, and listen to the whole thing. It's Long Song Saturday. This is what we do. So I've only heard a little bit from Vangelis. We've listened to a little bit of him and John Anderson's music on here, which, by the way, John Anderson features on the first half of the album. So I figured, you know what, now is a good time. I'm familiar with a few of his other songs, most notably the soundtrack to Blade Runner, because that is an epic soundtrack. And I did not realize that he is the composer behind Chariots of Fire. You know, that inspirational song? Bum, 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 bum. That one? Like, the one that you feel, like, inspired and you see people running? Had no idea, so that's really cool. I also briefly watched about a minute of an interview with him, just so I could make sure that I was pronouncing his name correctly. Vangelis. Not Vangelis. That's what I was saying before. And I know a lot of you corrected me, so sorry about that. I hope that you guys enjoy this video, enjoy this album listen. I don't know how popular or not popular this is, but that's kind of one of the advantages, I guess, about not being a YouTuber who relies on the videos making money, because the videos don't make me money. Is that I can kind of do whatever I want. I don't have to worry too much about what's popular and, you know, what to get the most views or not. And we'll go from there. It definitely helps if you do support me on Patreon. I mean, that's the whole reason I can do more videos, do longer videos, and things like that. Because I can just take a little time off work, record a little bit more, put a little more effort into the channel. I hope that you guys enjoy that. So without further ado, I've talked enough. Like I said, we'll do the first half, which includes the songs, apparently, Bacchanale, Symphony to the Powers B, Movement 3, and then ending with So Long Ago, So Clear, and then next week we'll do the second half of the album. So, without further ado, thank you so much for being here. Hope that you enjoy your time here, hope that you enjoy the music, hope that you enjoy myself. We'll sit here, we'll listen for 20 minutes or so, and we'll talk about what we heard afterwards. This is Vangelis with Heaven and Hell, Part 1, Side 1. Thank you.
kissed a million stars and touched as only one can. Once we did play, how the past delivered you amidst our youth, we dreamed.
Okay, hear me out, okay? For anyone who clicked on this video and who watched to this point, to which I'm speaking right now, you already knew before you clicked on this video that my favorite part of the song was going to be when John came in at the end. Right? Like, that's not a spoiler. Right? Like, you already knew that. Because, listen, this song grew on me as it went, and at about 13 minutes, there was a moment there when the piano melody comes in, and I was like, oh my god, this is gorgeous. This is so easily my favorite part of the song. And then, you know, about 8 minutes later or so, I'm proved wrong. Because as soon as Vangelis starts to swell on the music, like little starburst of color, and John comes in with his just holy and vibrant voice that just sings and floats on top of these cosmic waves that Vangelis is putting out there. That's the moment that hits me. That's the one that hits my heart that really, like, wrenches my heart. Like, I'm listening to the end, and I'm just feeling my heart swirling like a whirlpool. I can't help it. You guys know that I love John, right? Like, no doubt. Duh. And I'm sorry to talk about John when this is a song for Vangelis, but hear me out. I love John's voice. I love the way he sounds. I like the vibrancy he adds to whatever setting he's in. Here, I haven't heard everything from Yes, but I have heard a decent amount. This is, for myself, as of this moment, this is one of the most beautiful moments that I've heard from John. This is one of the most standout vocal performances specifically from John that I've heard. Yes, absolutely because of his singing, no doubt, but also because of the grand composure and emotional weight that Vangelis is like creating behind him. And then John is just that Silver Surfer just riding the Celestials. No doubt. This was a great song. So another thing that I really should have mentioned before is that the songs that I mentioned in the beginning that I've heard from Vangelis, that's all I know. So I don't know anything about his albums. I don't know anything about like his direct musical output. So this is the first I've heard of like him. And can I say, I had no idea that this is what I was going to be getting, because this was an electronic soundscape, a cinematic and classical kind of piece, taking us from way different parts of mood, from, you know, earth scorching, you know, hells, basically, into the skies opening up into heavenly bliss. Absolutely heavenly bliss. I was not expecting that, to be honest. I guess maybe just because of what I'm familiar with, especially on this channel, I was expecting Prague. Not disappointed. I just had to readjust myself because it's not what I was expecting. But wow, what a first half of an album. Definitely left impressed. As I mentioned, I really wasn't expecting the classical sound that we got here. I was expecting something completely different, but hey, that's okay, that's okay. That's what we're here for, right? First listen, it's all a surprise no matter what. So I think that it's cool how the song was broken up into different parts, as I see here, but those different parts actually evoked different moods, right? So just looking at what it's broken up into, the first part entitled Bacchanal, or Bacchanale, I'm not 100% sure. I know that, if I remember correctly, my gods, Bacchus, god of like partying, festivities, wine, I believe. And I think that's, it might actually be Bacchanal, or there's a holiday like for him. Baka, not Baka like Japanese for idiot, but there's an actual holiday. Let me just look it up really quick. Bacchanalia. So Bacchanalia is a Roman festival of Bacchus. Also, it just means drunken revelry, which kind of sounds fun, to be honest. Sounds like a cool holiday. So I like how that part, when we're introduced to it, that is like the searing fire in the sky opening that we get in the album. With those really sharp and driving synth sounds, you have some choir in there, and it's a very dark, gloomy, and heavy sound that you're getting in that moment. And then there's a part right after that kind of like gives it a little tempo. There's some drums that come in as well. I love that. And then one of the most interesting things about that I wasn't expecting out of this, amidst that fiery blaze of the opening, you hear some keyboard and piano work. And it sounds just like straight jazz. And I only heard it like right there. But that is such a cool and unique flavor for Vangelis to throw in there amidst that classical burn. Was like jazz chords. That was really, really interesting. That was a super creative choice. Like, listen to right here. Amongst the inferno. And that. Listen. I am in love with this section of the song just set ablaze. That is awesome. That's a fantastic way to open up the album. When it gets there, oh, I'm in. Don't listen to the wah, 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 wah. I mean, that part's cool too, but listen to the keys in the back. You You know what it kind of reminds me of, actually? It reminds me of Canterbury scene and sound. Whereas it has like that jazzy sound, but there's something kind of unique about it. Something flavored a little bit different. And actually that sounds a little bit like the way Canterbury keyboardist would play that particular section. Kind of like Greenslade, right? Sounds like something you would hear from Greenslade or something like that. Maybe even Soft Machine? I don't know. But that is like a really intense way to open up the album. And I think that that sounds really cool. When it's in this whole swing of things, this is just so brilliant. You know? Like, I feel like this album's going somewhere. You know? And then it ends with a little bit of a boom right here as we move into the second part, which, if I pull it up here, we get into the Symphony to the Powers B. Movements 1, 2, and eventually 3. Okay, I cannot for the life of me remember what the song is because I sat here for just a minute thinking about it, but listen to this part. It sounds like something from another song that I've heard and it's in there, but I can't bring it forth what song that reminds me of. Like, you guys know what I'm talking about? There's like a keyboard part in a song, and we've listened to it here, I'm pretty sure. It goes, bum, 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 bum. Like, is it ELP or... No, I actually... Man, someone's going to say it in the comments, and I think one of you knows what I'm talking about. But it's bothering me, because I can hear that part, but I can't place the artist or band that does it. Oh, man. And it's probably like one of my favorite songs or something. So, I'll be honest. This part, I wasn't in love with. After all the drive and fury that the initial Bacchanal had, you know, begun and stirred up, as it moved into this section, I didn't think it was bad. I just thought it took away some of the steam that was built up. I like the choir. You know, I like those twinkly keys as well. And there are some moments within this section I do enjoy. But at least on a first listen, I kind of lost a little bit of interest right here. And I'm not in love in this particular section with all the synth sounds that are chosen. I actually feel maybe like organ or even, I don't know, different keys or pianos might have sounded a little better. I do think the mixture of synth and piano works very well here, especially with the choir in these very bombast moments. And it's in that section that I really quickly had to look up lyrics because honestly, I didn't really think about it. And I thought that this might be instrumental. So I pulled up lyrics really quick on Vangelis. See, I told you I'd mess up. Lyrics.com. And it looks like these lyrics at first, which I thought might have been Latin, as I would expect from a choir, apparently are actually just in a made-up language. Educati, celibatu, pese, rutu. I don't know. It's a bunch of words. But apparently it's just a made-up language really made to more sound good. And hey, it does sound good. And this was really cool. Like, that's cool, you know? So some of the mixture between piano and choir, some of it works really well, some of it falls a little flat for me, but I think overall, if I was to take it all together, I think it's pretty nice.
But, from this simple, relaxed, and gorgeous melody, forward is where this song really reaches heights. For me. Speaking of heights, I don't know if this is a thing for the album or if I'm just pushing my own ideas on the album, but I was expecting basically out of an album named Heaven and Hell, in which there are two long songs and two distinct sides, I would have thought that one side would represent hell, the other heaven. One probably being darker, moodier, like we heard in the first half of this song, and one being a lot lighter and a lot more floaty and light-hearted, as we're hearing from here forward. And yet, I don't know if that idea will stick, I don't know if that concept will make sense, because I have to listen to the second side of the album, but at least in here, it actually shows a nice duality between the two just within this side. So maybe, I don't know if this is what they're going for, but maybe the two aren't so far apart to be on different sides. Maybe there's a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B, just in the mix of it all. Anyways, let's get back to this, guys. This is so stunningly and painstakingly beautiful. I could listen to this all day. And I was hoping that this wouldn't go away. I was like, this
is where my heart's at. Let's stay in this place for a while. And not only did he stay, he enlivened. The music began to breathe. The music began to take its own life. Not take its own life, but like to take life. Not to take life like kill, but become alive. It became sentient in a sense. It moved on its own. Listen to how brilliantly bright these organs play. Like we're in some sort of cosmic church, a cosmic cathedral. That's what I feel. And man, I'd be here for Mass every day. And those inspirational synths, they kind of weave their way in, providing a lot more momentum into the piece, a lot more forward direction and movement. The melody even sounds like the song I mentioned before, Chariots of Fire. Like I said, that was my favorite moment in the song. Right up until this whole ending, when you know who, Mr. Anderson, I ain't talking about, Neo, came in. Changes everything. This whole next 5 minutes is blissful. Absolutely blissful. I kind of mentioned it in the beginning when we first started talking about this, but it sounds like the two are just so in harmony. John with his sweet, heavenly, blissful vocals, as I mentioned. It feels like his breath is just breathing color. And Vangelis is just there, acting as this outer space... what are the guys called? That are swinging their hands with the music. Band leader, conductor. That's what I mean. And Vangelis just feels like an out-of-orbit conductor, an in-orbit conductor, spacey conductor, to this beautiful swelling, inhaling, and exhaling of music. That is just so beautiful. That is gorgeous. I am not going to be over that for a while. We did love. Long ago, how did I forget? Holding hands close. Every single emotional swell hits. I don't want to listen to it again because it's so beautiful. It is one of those pieces at the end that, not that everything else preceding it was bad or anything like that, but it just makes the ending so much more sweet. In a sense, bittersweet, because, you know, it's the ending of part one. And as far as I know, at least I don't see him credited anywhere, John is nowhere to return in part two. So there's that. All right, let's talk about the lyrics. I'm not going to talk about the made-up ones and the powers to be. So let's talk about So Long Ago, So Clear. Once we did run, how we chased a million stars and touched as only one can. Once we did play, how the past delivered you. Amidst our youth, we dream away. As if I knew the words, I'm sure you'll hear of how we met, as you recall, so clear. Once we did love, long ago. How did I forget holding you so closely? Look how I move. Chance would have me glance at you to know how you move me. Me, all barriers fall around us as we hear of memories known and matters long ago so clear. Then the ending, once we did run, how we chased a million stars and touched as only one can. Just beautiful poetry, as I would expect from John. I don't know if John wrote this or if Vangelis wrote this. It sounds maybe like John wrote this. I'm not sure, though. Regardless, I think the lyrics speak really nicely. To what do they speak of? Speaking to someone perhaps you've lost connection with, someone lost. Looking back on those past memories, as he says, once. So many times he starts off the stanza with once. We did this, we did this. And then the next few lines, he starts with look. And then me. So taken from the past, memorizing, or rather reminiscing on the past, in a way bringing those feelings, those memories to life in the present. As long as you hold your loved ones, even if they're lost, as long as you hold them in your memories and your thoughts, they'll always be there. And in some way, they'll always be alive. Just reading off Wikipedia, it
says here that in 1975, Vangelis moved to London where he set up his own studios, Nemo Studios. The album was his first record he made at the studio. He says, I was trying to put together the studio recording while recording. Or he says, I was trying to put together the studio while recording the first album, Heaven and Hell, at the same time. In fact, the studio was hell because there was unmixed concrete everywhere, builders all over the place making a lot of noise, and next to all that, there I was trying to finish my album. Amidst all the work, all the contractors, all the concrete, he's here trying to make a little bit of an epic, you know, sound. There was no limit as to how much time I could spend working on the album, but I felt I just had to do it in any case. The only way you can complete the construction of a studio quickly is to start working in it before it's actually finished. Good point. And then it also says that Vangelis played all the instruments except the choir, which I think is quite stunning, and it really shows like all the artfulness he has in his mind to put all of that emotion and sound to music, and specifically into a concept. Sometimes it's hard to fit your emotions and the music you want to put out. It's hard to fit that into a concrete concept. And I think that this actually kind of allows him to have a little bit of playfulness with that concept. He's not so stuck in making a Heaven and Hell album. He's just making an album with flame and with water and air and light and dark and all of that good stuff. Hope that you guys enjoyed the video. Thank you for watching, first of all. Thank you for clicking the video. Thank you for getting to this point, if you've gotten to this point. If you haven't, I guess you won't you won't see this, but if it's your first time here on the channel, I hope that you enjoyed it. I hope that you stop in the comments and say a hi. If it's like, you know, your 100th time on the channel, I hope the exact same thing. Thank you for being here once again. I cannot thank you enough for sitting here and enjoying the music with me, as I hope that you have. You're more than welcome. Follow me on Twitter. Comment below. Let me know your thoughts, of course. I'd like to know that on this song, or on this half, rather, as we move on to the next. And if you'd like, you can support the channel on Patreon, as it does help a lot in me doing these longer songs, more videos, all of that kind of stuff. Of course, you don't have to, as I mentioned. Hope that you just enjoyed your time here. And we'll finish up the second half of the album next week, next Saturday. Hope you're back for that. And that's all I got. I got no more talking. Have a fantastic day. I will talk to you tomorrow. Bye.